So glad you're here. This is going to be a very special time as we meet with the Lord and as we remember and honor Mary Nelson White. So Lord, we thank you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that you are here. You're more present than we are, for you're infinite. And we just thank you, that, Lord, we ask that you'd make this time such a special time for the family and friends and everyone here. May they experience your love. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Today we've gathered as family and friends to remember, honor, and celebrate Mary Nelson White. Born December 26, 1922, in Morristown, Tennessee. She went to heaven to be with the love of her life, John White, on March 29th, 2023, at the age of 100. She graduated from Duke University in 1944, and soon thereafter she met her future husband, John White, on a blind date. They had a brief courtship in Miami, Florida, and on the day he did not call her, she knew that his Army Military Intelligence Unit had been deployed to China. John wrote a book of his China adventures, including many of the letters sent back and forth between the two of them. They married soon after the war on April 5th, 1946, and had three children, John, Vicky, and Molly. Wow, what a legacy you have been left. You're very blessed, very blessed. Let us pray. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we thank you that you are here to engage us in our hearts because you love us deeply. Thank you that you love us not so much for what we do, but for who we are. Thank you for that kind of real, right relationship that we have with you by grace. Lord, we're not saying that we've earned it or we deserve it. We know, Lord, that it's simply by your great love for us. And we just thank you for that, Lord, and we praise you. So again, Lord, bless this time with us right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand and join in singing hymn 834 in your hymnals? Hymn 834, Precious Lord, Take My Hand, and we'll sing the first. Well, there's just two. Okay, good. We'll do both. All right. You may be seated. I'm going to read from Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. And these are the very words of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, told in kind of contemporary terms, but yes, the very heart and message of Jesus inviting us to come to him. And so he says to us, are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Come to me, get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me, work with me, watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Just keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Isn't he wonderful? Yeah. And I love it when Jesus said, so if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So if you want to know what this powerful, transcendent God, Lord God Almighty, what he's like, you look at Jesus and you realize, my, our Heavenly Father is also humble and gentle and kind and patient and accessible and understanding. Yeah. Real persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who say, come. They say, come. You know, you might be sitting there and saying, you know what? I don't believe. And I want you to know that's all right. But I want you to think about something. Could it be that maybe you really haven't rejected the Lord Jesus Christ? Maybe it's just that you have rejected the version of him that's been presented to you. He loves you. He wants you to be real. Don't want to turn your brain off. He's engaging. It's real simple. Very relational. He says, come. Come. I also want to read from Romans chapter 8. Verse 31 and following, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also praying for us. He knows we need it. He's praying for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. God bless your word. Thank you for your covenant that you've given to us. We give you praise. Well, I just met Mary Nelson this year. And her son John, we had a providential, serendipitous meeting. We didn't know it was going to happen, but it did. And we just had so much in common. And he told me about his mother, and I said, oh, I'd love to meet her. I mean, after all, she graduated from Duke University, and my mother and father graduated from Duke University, about that same era. So had some interest there, but the things that had been said. And so I met with her, and Johnson graciously allowed us to have some time alone, and she shared, and of course, the main thing is John White. Oh, just, you know, the nonverbals coming from her body language, from their tone of voice, everything just spoke so sweetly about her love. And he passed, what, about 20 years ago? And it's as though he's right there as she would share her love for him and their life together. It was just amazing to hear. In fact, John and Vicki and Molly, a personal note, as I met with her, it did remind me of my mother. They're both Southern women, both beautiful, charming, hospitable, intelligent, sensitive. And so I'm talking to her, and I'm reminded of my mother, not knowing at that time that they both went to Duke. Go Duke. I didn't say that. Yeah, I mean, we do have to follow that basketball, you know, and see what's going on here. Anyway, Dad played for Duke, and so it was a very important time. They met there and got married, and so it was just meant a lot to me, found out that your mom graduated from there. So after the first time meeting her, then John and I met again, and handed me a note from Mary Nelson. May I read it to you? Well, I'm going to anyway. So Mary, here goes. You know, private's going public here in just a minute. Hi, John. Really enjoyed meeting and talking to you yesterday. I got so busy talking about dying that I forgot to tell you the good news of John coming back. Just for a second or two, twice, and about the pennies from heaven. My best to you always. Keep up the good work. Love in him, Mary Nelson. I'm feeling it right now. So I do want to share with you what she shared with me. Family, you have probably heard these before, but let's share it with others. So, first of all, after John passed, and the next morning she came here to meet with the pastor to be comforted, and so she parks in the church parking lot, opens the door to step out, and as she does, she sees a penny on the ground. Oh, he's here. He's talking to me, because he knew I love to find money on the ground, don't we all? But yeah, so, and then she found many pennies through the years, and in her heart and mind, that meant so much to her. She said she even found a silver heart in the parking lot. Yeah, so I can just see it. We're going to dismiss. I'm going to see all of you kind of looking around for some treasure. I can just see it. After he passed, she said that she had a dream. And in that dream, he came and sat on her bed. And she said, it was so real. I touched him and said, oh, John, what is heaven like? And he said, you'll just have to wait. Boy, she got angry. In 1954, after a miscarriage in the hospital, she became very ill. All of a sudden, there in the hospital room, nobody else was in the room, but there she was, and she had an out-of-body experience. And so she said, as many do, as I'm going to this beautiful place, the light. Now, it's not a, as she said, it was not a blaring kind of light. Calming. Just beautiful. And she said, I want to stay here. This is so great. Again, she got this was the first time that somebody said, it's not your time. Aren't you glad? Yeah. She had a few more things to do. On the program, I'd like to read this poem that she wrote. And so I invite you, if you'd like to see those two lovebirds looking at each other. And this is what she wrote on their 40th anniversary on April 5th, 1984. Surely the glory of the Lord has been revealed to me in the beauty of the sun as it sinks into the sea, in the touching of the hands and the way you look at me. My cup, it runneth over as I walk with God and thee, resting firmly on his promise that the best is yet to be. How I bless and praise his name each and every day for sending you to me. Wow. Just beautiful. Just beautiful. I'd like to share just a few thoughts from John chapter 14. So this is a time with his disciples. He's preparing them for him to leave. They are very upset because he keeps talking this way, that he's going to be leaving them. And so we have this very precious time of chapter 14, 15, and 16 where he gives them instructions, and he starts out by saying this: Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. And you know the way to the place that I'm talking about. You know, family, so here you are. And Jesus says to you, don't let your hearts be troubled. Well, on the one hand, you've suffered great loss. You are suffering great loss. And that's a reality. And I encourage you to lean into it. Yeah. On the other hand, there is this, right, relief that she's fine now, no more pain, no more suffering, and she's with John. And so there is this tension between this hope that we have, and hope for us is not a, oh, I hope it happens, it's a confident expectation of the future. So it's this, and Jesus wants you to know it's all right, and you're going to be all right. He says, trust in me. I remember when I put my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as a teenager. And then through the years, and then as a retired educator of many students over the years, and being able to encourage them in their following Jesus. And many times I would say, so why are you following him? Do you know why? Probably many reasons. Right there at the top, I trust his character. I trust the person that he is. And Jesus is saying, trust me. I know you're upset. This doesn't fit the way you think things ought to be, but trust me, trust me. In my Father's house are many rooms. I share with the family that Jesus, after his resurrection, did something very important to help his disciples take in the fact that his resurrected body was a real body with five senses that was going to live forever, a body. You know what he did? He fixed breakfast. And he fed them. And they touched him because he wanted them to know that he had a real body. To be human is to be a body. A mind, a will, a spirit, to be a body. And Jesus won that for us, and he wants us to know that one day we will have a new body. Anybody here looking for one? Growing older is not for sissies, I'll tell you that. That wonderful, precious body, the Lord Jesus Christ, ascended 40 days after his resurrection. He ascended into heaven, and his going up was slow enough that they watched him do it. And again, wow, you mean we're going to have a real body in heaven? Because heaven is a real place. It's a real place. It's not a typical, oh, just a lot of clouds and little cherubs and they're strumming a guitar or something. No, it's real. It's a real place. And there are specially appointed places for you, for me, for Mary, for John. And Jesus wants us to know that he loves us that much that we're just getting started. Mary, 100 years of age, just getting started. So many more experiences, and there'll be no pain or disappointment or anything. No wars or rumors of wars, no, none of that. And to be with family. You know, I have a mother and a father, a brother and two sisters, and grandparents who've gone on before. And we as a family, my many sons and daughters, my many grandchildren, brothers and sisters, we love to talk about heaven. Because we know that the people who meant so much to us are so happy, and we're going to see them again. And that faith is a gift that God freely gives. And we just receive it. And we're so thankful for his promises. Because of his integrity, we know it's true. He's telling his disciples, I'm going to prepare places for you. So I go, I'll prepare the place, and I want you to know I'm going to come back to take you with me, just as when Mary White left her body and took the hand of Jesus I can just hear it. Now's time. Okay, come on. Now it's time. And she's so happy it's time. He personally, intimately, lovingly, very relationally takes the loved one to where he is and to family and friends, and wow, what a place. I hope heaven is a very real place to you. It looks a lot like the earth. According to the Word of God, it looks a lot like the earth, but perfect. But the things you see here, the trees, the gardens, the mountains, the animal kingdom, the plant kingdom, all these wonderful creations of God for our joy. There we go. We're just getting started. Main thing, Jesus says, so you'll be where I am. He's so accessible. He's so gentle. He's so kind. So I want to encourage you in your relationship with the Lord. Accept his invitation that it's not hard. Don't make it too hard. And remain who you are. Be real. And know that you're unique. And just ask him to keep revealing himself to you in simple, gentle, loving, non-judgmental ways that he does. Aren't you glad we don't have to add up? That's just too much to carry. I hope you're not carrying that. Trying to add up. And sometimes religion really will put that on you. And in his days, that was going on. And, you know, so he wanted them to, come on now. This is about grace. You all are still growing. We're going to do some stupid things, but, well, come on now. We're still growing and learning, and you don't have to add up. We'll never earn it. We don't deserve it, but the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit love us so deeply. Every one of you, every one of us, and they're so present, so present. Bless you, Lord, for your word. So Lord, yes, we thank you for this invitation for us to draw closer to you. Lord, we put down everything that we try to do or any self-effort performance. We simply do it, not so that we have you, but because we do have you. Thank you for your unconditional love. Thank you that you've shown us the way to heaven. And thank you that right now in our life, may we be like Mary Nelson White. You were so real to her, so real. She wanted to stay with you. But it wasn't her time. Now it is, and there she is. So we thank you for her. We give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and turn to our hymnal and sing together 825. We'll be singing, I think I got it right this time. Let me look first. I think it's going to be the first and the last verse. Yep, got it. Thank you. seated. We have an opportunity here for family and friends to share and to say whatever's on your heart about Mary Nelson White. And so I've asked her son, John, to come at this time, and he'll be sharing. And as you do, keep in mind that there may be others, but certainly we want to hear from you about your love and your experiences. So, John.
I've been here before, up here. So John referred to an event in my mother's life 69 years ago, 1954, when she had an amazing personal encounter with Jesus, a near-death experience. And there are three things that happened in that experience. The first thing is she discovered that God is real. Up until then, she was a good Presbyterian, went to church regularly, but something went to a much greater level in that experience. God was real. The second thing she discovered is that that God communicates with us. He wants to speak to us if we'll listen. Prayer is not monologue, it's dialogue. She discovered that. The third thing she discovered is that that God who speaks wants us to know how much he loves us more than anything else. And again, love went from maybe a theological concept to an experiential reality for her that absolutely changed her life. By the way, about 13 years ago, I recorded an interview with Mom where she tells the story herself. And if you'd like to see that, just shoot me an email. I'll send you the link. And you can listen to her talk about that in her own words. A number of years after that, she discovered a little book that resonated with her. It was sort of the same three things, that God is real, that he speaks, and he wants us to know that he loves us deeply. It's a little book called Jesus Calling. One of the things she said after that experience back in 1954 is she thought maybe she should go out on the street and stop people and tell them what she had discovered. She thought she might have been the only person who had ever experienced that. She found out that stopping people in the street probably wasn't a good idea. But she still had that desire for the rest of her life to let people know what she had discovered. And one of the ways that she did that is wrapped up in this little book called Jesus Calling. It's a book that she read every day for the last, I don't know how many years. And she gave them away like crazy. Periodically, Molly's nodding there, she would say, could you order me another three copies of that book? I have some people I want to give it to. In fact, let me see a show of hands. How many of you got a copy of this book? Come on, look at that, holy cow. So, what we've done, for the few of you here who haven't yet gotten a copy of this, we've ordered 20 copies, and they'll be on the table at the reception. If you don't have one, I'd encourage you to pick one up. They're just little daily readings from a lady named Sarah Young, who discovered the same thing that my mother had discovered. So again, that was the defining event of her life. It changed her life, and more than anything else, she wanted her friends and family, doesn't matter how well she knew you, she wanted you guys to know that same thing. So that's available. So I think my sister Vicky is next, and then Mark, and then we have a little bit of time left for anyone else. Come on up.
Thank you all for coming. For quite some time before Mom passed away, she's talked about her funeral. and that she wanted it to be a bright, happy celebration. And so that's what we're going to do. She, as you know, always dressed in sort of soft pastel and bright colors, and whether that was for a funeral or anywhere else. And so this is a Mary Nelson approved outfit. So I wanted to recount a few special memories. First of all, she was a wonderful storyteller. And even though her short-term memory declined in the last few years, there was absolutely no issue with her long-term memory. I'm sure that all the grandkids and the older great-grands remember the story of the mouse in the pocket and other tales of her childhood, her mischievous childhood, that she would tell. Since Dad had written a book about his China experiences, not to be outdone, she decided to write her own book called Love Never Ends, which is a delightful recounting of her life, including those early years. As her short-term memory declined, much to her frustration, so did her ability to do math and to follow her investments. Prior to this, and well into her 90s, she always balanced her checkbook by hand, never using a calculator, and most definitely not a computer, and always balancing to the exact penny. Balancing to the penny also went along with being very, very frugal. Yet, she was incredibly generous in so many different ways. Most notably, she and Dad funded school tuition, for multiple generations. But for that first generation, which would be my siblings and me, never to be phrased my siblings and I, or you would be struck down. She and Dad always joked that they had invested very shrewdly in our educations. As Molly became a nurse to help care for them if they were ill, and she got lots of work from that end, I, as a physical therapist, could help rehabilitate them. And then, once we both failed, Johnny gets the berry. They thought that was very smart. And I would say that the three of us have been a pretty effective team. Mom was able to be so generous because she never wasted anything. And she used her money very wisely. And she was always trying to teach us the same, including all the generations. She loved to quote from her father, his advice, which was to take care of the nickels and the dimes, and the dollars will take care of themselves. And every one of us have heard, oh, I can't tell you how many times, spend the income, but never the principal. Not many people make it to 100 years of age while still living independently in their own home. In the health and wellness space, which I sort of am in, there is a lot of spin these days about longevity and how to achieve it. And it all revolves around healthy eating, especially avoiding sugar, lots of exercise, intermittent fasting, and of course, no smoking and very little drinking. Well, Mom didn't exactly follow those rules. The only parts she partially got right were the exercise component, and she did stop smoking years ago. And even in the last few years, she decided to stop drinking and instead substituted a little emergency packet in ice water as her cocktail in the evening. But she certainly never fasted, nor did she limit sugar. Even though her appetite had declined, she always enjoyed three meals a day, followed by dessert, usually something chocolate, except for breakfast, when it was usually just a muffin and other kinds of sugar. And when she ate fruit or vegetable, it was never, ever organic, because she didn't believe in that and she thought it was dirty. Any vegetable would be doused, not in olive oil or butter, but in a squeeze container of I can't believe it's not butter, large amounts. And any dessert would have a very healthy dollop or two or three of Cool Whip. Perhaps all of those preservatives were the secret to her longevity. No matter how she got there, she lived a long and a full life that enriched the lives of her progeny as well as many others. And I'll leave you with one other very simple, happy snippet that was in her love story book that we've all probably heard, but it's yesterday is history, tomorrow is a mystery, today is a gift. That's why it's called the present. Thank you, Mom.
Good afternoon. Pastor John, one of my stories about Mary Nelson was the parking lot also. Molly and I would drive Mary Nelson to church here every Sunday. Mary Nelson was very meticulous, very particular. She, no matter how many times we went to church, I drove her to church, she always had to give me driving instructions. And when we get to the parking lot, she'd say, now go down this row, and then she'd further proceed, now park in that spot. Same row, same spot, every Sunday. Well, one Sunday I decided to suggest to Mary Nelson, Mary Nelson, why don't we park closer to the church? We use those handicapped spaces. Oh no, Mary Nelson said, we need to save those for somebody who needs it. I think she was 95 at that time. Now, for the past 5 years or more, Molly and I have had the privilege to spend evenings every week with Mary Nelson. Dinner was always at 7 p.m. Not 6:55, not 7:05. Mary Nelson said, we will sit down at 7 p.m. Now, before dinner, Mary Nelson loved to watch the evening news. We watched World News with David Muir. Why? Well, Molly and Mary Nelson thought David had big, beautiful hair. He was easy on the eyes. After the evening news, hearing some of the most disturbing, most horrific events and news of the day, Mary Nelson would look over and say, well, there must be some good news somewhere. That's Mary Nelson, always optimistic. And yes, Mary Nelson, there is some good news somewhere, and that's here today as we celebrate your 100 years of life. You know, I'm going to miss our evening conversations around the dinner table. Mary Nelson loved to reminisce about her family, her church, growing up in Morristown, Tennessee. She shared, as you alluded to, of her special memories of her life together with John like it was just yesterday. And then she did tell stories about John, Vicky, and Molly growing up in West Virginia and Bethesda. And there's one story in particular about Molly that I have to share. Mary Nelson had Molly ready to go to school, and they're at the front door, and at that time, they walked to school. So Mary Nelson leaned over to Molly and said, Molly, go and have a great day. Molly looked at her and said, don't tell me what to do. Now, looking back, I think Mary Nelson may have told me that for a reason. I have yet to tell Molly to go and have a good day. I've lost my place here. All right, please bear with me here. I want to get this. Molly was Mary Nelson's strong-willed, independent child. But it was Molly who, her fierce independence, her strong-willed little girl, that was with her mother till the very end and made sure that she had a great... It was Molly in the end that said, I'm going to make sure that my mom has a great day. And that's the story about John, Vicky, and Molly. They were devoted to their mother. That's what I got to witness. John, every Wednesday, would take his mother to her weekly hair appointment with her hairdresser, Diane. He would come over on at least one or two days a week, and he'd sit in the living room and share stories with his mother, talking about W&L and other things. Mary Nelson loved her time with you, loved the fact that you would take time for those conversations. I was going to talk about Vicky and the same checkbook store, because it was a phone call that you had to take by your mom that she was so upset about that. Vicky had a very calming influence on her mother. You don't live to be 100 without a lot of support. Mark Carpenter, Vicky's husband, on his visits to Naples, Mary Nelson always had a to-do list for Mark And Mark's pretty handy, pretty talented in those in the handyman skills. And then there's Joel Ramsey. Joel is Margie's husband. Margie is Mary Nelson's granddaughter. Joel came to the rescue several times. I say all this because it allowed me to do what I was talented at. And every Tuesday night, I rolled those garbage cans out to the curb for Molly. Very impressive, very impressive. In closing, I'm going to say I want to remember Mary Nelson as most gracious. I'll remember Mary Nelson as incredibly generous, a strong woman of faith, the matriarch of her family. Thank you all for being here to celebrate her incredible span of life from 1922 to 2023. And I want you to picture this. This was my aha moment in trying to write down some thoughts about Mary Nelson. Picture this. Mary Nelson and John holding hands. Mary Nelson looking into the eyes of John and saying, "Look, John, we made it. We're back together again." And that is the good news somewhere. John and Mary Nelson back together again. Thank you.
We have a few more minutes, and just a few. Is there somebody else that would like to come? And I think we'll get it started now. So if you do feel more comfortable there, but please, you're welcome up here.
Hello? Sorry. Okay. Well, I'm Mary Frances. Half of my name comes from Mary Nelson. And I had to write down notes because they don't teach you public speaking in nursing school. So this is not very easy for me. But I'm not going to lie, Mary Nelson was a very intimidating woman to me while I was a little girl. She was kind of strict. She had opinions about what we wear. I keep feeling like I'm listening, like, behind me if she's approving of my outfit today. But she wanted the most for us, for me and for us. Like when she forbade me from getting married before I completed nursing school. I don't know how she had the foresight to push me to finish something that I had started that was to be, besides my children, the single most rewarding years of how I've spent my life being a nurse. And that I did end up getting married. I did finish nursing school first, and then I got married. But that marriage ended 17, 18 years later. But today I get to still be a nurse, and I love it. And had she not pushed me to stay focused and finish, I may have not had that. And so even though she was intimidating, as everyone else said, she was a storyteller. And I appreciated that side to her, not only because it was entertaining for all of us to be able to listen to her stories, but it's bigger than that. Stories transform intimidating people into humans that we feel like we can relate to, like when they tell us about their cowboy outfits when they were little girls and how they were tomboys and wanted to play with all the boys. Stories, again, are not just entertaining, but I think they are what break down barriers between people who disagree on politics or the news. Because it allows us to feel each other's humanity in very personal ways. And I had this quote that I found that we live in a world where joy and empathy and pleasure are all around us, there for the noticing, And it's the storytellers that help us to see those things. And she did that because she picked up on little tiny details that made the story come alive and helped me to see things that I may have missed by being busy in my life or preoccupied with my own problems. And the last thing I wanted to read was one other quote, is that story, as it turns out, was crucial to our evolution, more so than opposable thumbs. Opposable thumbs let us hang on. A story told to us is what we hang on to. And I appreciate that she passed that down to my father, who is also a very good storyteller. And I hope that her touching everyone else with her stories carries on why that's important to have storytellers in our lives, so that it keeps us connected.
Sharon, if more of you have something to share, I want to invite you to meet with the family and share those things. Thank you, those of you that shared. Appreciate so much your words. So, let's sing. So now this time, we actually have the song is going to come, if it works, over the intercom. So let's stand and join in singing Surely the Presence. This concludes our time together here. And so I bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May His presence go with you. You're dismissed as the organ plays, and you've been invited to go to Moss Hall for a reception.